Tēnā koutou kei ngā kaipapuri I ngā tikanga rātou mā nau mai hoki mai ki Tapatahi. Welcome back and thanks for joining us. Tapatahi is our new multi-platform program that tells you everything you need to know about COVID-19. And we'd love to know what you think, so please let us know if you have a question or comment on our Facebook page. Well, coming up on today's show, Dr. Sarah Shasha, she's back to answer your health questions. We talk with New Zealand Nurses Organisation Kaiwhakahaere Kerry Nuku about the lengths nurses are going to protect their whānau from risk of infection with COVID-19. Bay of Plenty Regional Councillor Toi Itzi joins us to discuss the pitfalls and potential of life in a COVID-19 world. We catch up with the CEO of Papakura Marae, Tony Kake, on how their food bank is coping with increased demands, and the sisters behind the Facebook page Lockdown Entertainment return to sing us a beautiful waiata. But first, here's what you need to know in 30 seconds. E rua tekau mātahi ngā rākua hipa I te tīmatanga o te rāhui. That's right, it's day 21 in lockdown. There are 20 new cases, 6 are confirmed, 14 are probable. 113 are confirmed as Māori and 62 as Pacifica. 100 have recovered, which takes our new total cases to 1,386. 13 are in hospital, including 3 in ICU and 2 are in a critical condition. Just over 66,000 in total have been tested. Later today, we'll hear more about what life and business activity might look like under Alert Level 3. Government will decide on Monday whether to ease the tight restrictions when the initial 4-week lockdown period ends on Wednesday night. To our first kaupapa, visits to hospital emergency departments have halved since COVID-19 restrictions began. Pathology testing, acute general surgery and cardiac care wards are also down in numbers. Doctors say the reasons are varied but include fear of catching COVID-19 in hospital, lack of transport during lockdown or fears people are not allowed to go to hospital. Doctors say if people leave an illness or condition too long, it could become much worse and could even lead to death. As well as hospitals, GPs are also open for business, although not face-to-face. On a return visit to Tapatahi is our favourite Porirua GP, Dr. Sarah Shasha, to answer any questions you may have. Tēnā koe, Sarah. Ngā mihi ki a koe.
Ata Māori e te whānau. And can I just first, me mihi kā tika ki ngā mate o te ao, o te mutu nei, particularly Matua Huirangi Waikere Puru's whānau, our reo exponent. I just want to send my aroha to the whānau. We've had a big year of loss, te iwi Māori, so I just wanted to acknowledge that before we start.
Tautoko, me tautoko I ngā mihi, tēnā rau atu koe. It seems there's some fear and concern about turning up to the emergency department at a hospital. If people are feeling unwell, what should they do? What options do they have?
Okay, I want to make this really clear because I think this wasn't made clear when we were all told lockdown. It's lockdown, you need to stay home. It's really important that if you're unwell, whānau, you've got a telephone. Waiatu ki ngā tākuta, ring your doctor, ring your nurse. They're still there and absolutely waiting for you to call because it's been a little bit boring at times, dare I say it. So you can ring them, they can give you advice on what you should or shouldn't do. If something is really bad and happening to you, say you're having chest pain or trouble breathing, the ambulance is still available, so do call them too. Healthline is available if you're not 100% sure what you should do, but emergency departments are still there and waiting for you as well, and they protect themselves as well as they protect you from this COVID-19. So I just ask you to remove the fear, put it in the kete, put it in the cupboard, down the hallway, and be strong and ring us. Remember that GP consultations have only reduced by 70%, so we are still expected to see patients, 30% of our patients, and we're probably not even getting that much at the moment. So I'm making sure I'm seeing my patients. It's absolutely a pleasure to see faces, to meet with whānau, even if it is in the car park, but we are still here, so why am I?
So it sounds like there should be absolutely no reason why whānau, if they are presenting with any symptoms whatsoever, feeling ill, there should be no reason why they cannot reach out to a GP, to their GP, or to go to hospital, right?
Paitetika. Just like you would call the doctor for an ailment prior to the lockdown, same thing still applies now. We're here and waiting to triage your call. We can determine what we need to do, and that might be a phone call. It might be kānohi ki te kānohi on an online media. It might be a face-to-face if we deem that's necessary. And you know, we're all making sure as GPs that we're seeing our patients as we need to, and the emergency departments are crying out for our whānau to come as well. I've known of whānau who have had heart attacks at home, which hasn't been picked up because whānau are too scared to contact us. Don't be scared. Ka wae whakamā, call us.
Ka pai. And I take that it's better to be safe than sorry, right? So any form of illness, reach out.
Absolutely. Just like you would prior. Our phone lines were busy as prior to COVID-19, and now they've quietened down. And I do think that's about the rhetoric that was given out early on. Stay in your bubble, stay at home. But there wasn't mention right at the beginning about the importance of contacting us whānau, the doctors, if you need to. We are here waiting.
Now, of course, we want everyone to stay safe and stay healthy. What are the best ways for people to stay healthy during lockdown, during COVID-19?
So I guess, you know, the things that doctors would say would be exercise, eat healthily, te mea, te mea. But why don't we think outside the square? I want you to, whānau, to think about some goals. You've got some time at the moment. Dare I say quiet, because the tamariki are back at kura online, so it might be a bit busy while you're trying to do mahi too. But find your purpose. This is a great time to set some goals. Small ones might be thinking about things that you're grateful for during the day. But big things might be doing Iron Māori, Iron Man behind me, like my husband. Do that. Think about the things that you can do to make your life better after COVID-19. Important to get out and do some exercise still. Fresh air is good. And once you get out and do some exercise, it makes you feel good as well. Really important that you get the support you need too. So make phone calls to whānau. Do FaceTime like this if you need to. Talk over the fence if you need to. Go out and wave the flag like some of the whānau here in Porirua are doing with the New Zealand anthem. There's just so many ways to keep yourself healthy other than exercising and eating.
What about supplements?
Yeah, one more thing is staying in your bubble, because we're deep into the lockdown and I know bubbles are starting to pop. Yeah. Kia haumaru tonu whānau, just like that new waiata, stay tūtahi, we're in this together.
Stay in our bubbles, absolutely. Bye. I was going to ask, what about supplements? You talk about getting out and getting a bit of fitness and exercise, which is great. What about supplements like vitamins that you can get from the supermarket as an example? Is that recommended?
So if you're someone who takes supplements from the supermarket normally, and it makes you feel stronger and you can afford that, then carry on. There's no reason to stop that. Whether or not you go and start them now, kei a koe. There's no evidence at the moment to prove that supplements can cure or prevent COVID-19, but if you need to do things that make you feel good, that include buying supplements from the supermarket, then kei a koe. That is up to you to do that. It does cost a bit of money, though. Eating well is important.
Eat well. Get out, get some fitness. Great advice. Dr. Sarah Shasha, that's our time for today. Thank you again, as always, for joining us. Tēnā rā tū koe.
Me koe hoki e hoa. Ka kite te whānau.
Well, from doctors to nurses, some nurses have resorted to sleeping in a car in the garage to protect their whānau from risk of infection with COVID-19. New Zealand Nurses Organisation Kai Whakahaere Kerry Nuku has drafted He Kete Tāpuhi Ora. It outlines nurses' concerns and a list of requests to keep them safe during the COVID-19 pandemic. These include greater access to personal protective equipment, PPE, a place to stay if they risk infecting whānau at home, and more pay. With me now is Kerry Nuku. Tēnā koe, Kerry.
Tēnā koe.
What are the main pressures nurses are facing in dealing with COVID-19?
These are extraordinary times, full stop. So ordinarily, before COVID, what our nurses were saying is that we've already got an underfunded health system. We already have nursing shortages. We've already seen the increase of violence on nurses. So now we've got COVID, we've got extraordinary things that are happening to ensure isolation and protection. So this is a bubble that we're in, one that is unpredictable and that we have to respond to in a way to ensure that we are not the vectors or the people that go on and transmit and diseases or the virus. So these are extraordinary times. It is a crisis that we're in.
Does every nurse have the PPE that they need? Because we hear almost daily assurances from the Director General of Health, the Prime Minister as well, that there is enough to go around. Is that the case?
We're hearing the same things, but that's not what's happening across the mutu in terms of consistency of access to protective, personal protective equipment. So we've seen some areas, and remember when the COVID, when we went into level four, what the nurses organisation have been saying is that we need to make sure that we've got adequate stocks to deal with any surges, and that we need to make sure that we protect the workforce to go to work every day, which will reassure their whānau that they're safe. Now, what we'd had seen in the first few days is not every service was providing access to the PPE gear that was necessary. Then we saw a rationalisation guidelines put in place, which said this is what you should do, this is what you must use, and this is what you shouldn't use. So we have had members right up until today still saying we do not have access to the personal protective equipment that's important to keep us going to work every day.
You have a real concern for Māori nurses on the front line, for nurses all round, right? Working on the front line and in the community, why is that?
Because they go to work to do the very best that they can do. If we're not enabling them to do that because of the personal protective equipment, then we've got some serious, significant problems. Now, what we've seen is, as I said before, these are extraordinary times. So we need to recognise the pressure, not only on the nurse, but also on the whānau. Everybody is scared, everybody's anxious, everybody's potentially vulnerable. So we need to make sure that those people that we're putting out on the front line, we recognise that and we support them. And that's part of what this package is intended to do.
Some nurses are taking quite drastic steps to self-isolate from their whānau if they suspect they may have been in contact with COVID-19 symptoms. What are some of the measures you've heard of?
So we've had heard of our members that have their partner has either put up a tent in the garage, or they've used the second car, they've made a bed at the back of, in the back seat, or they've folded down the seats to put some mattresses in there, so that if the nurse felt at any reason that she was not safe enough or felt safe enough to be part of that whānau bubble, that she would go home and she would sit in this and isolate herself in the shed. And the reason why that was done is that she could still look out to see how the kids were going, could see them playing around in the yard or whatever. Her food would be delivered to the front of the door. She'd open it up once they've gone and then get it. And that was that selfless act to ensure that her whānau was safe, but to ensure that she could carry on going back to work every day to do what she is passionate about, caring.
What would you like to see for nurses who feel they can't go home for fear of putting their own whānau at risk?
I think the call and part of the package is to ensure that if nurses feel like that, there is free accommodation, free food, free access to supporting them to make that choice. The difficulty is with Māori nurses is that we want to also see that we're part of that whānau. You know, it's really reassuring to know that your whānau are well. If we have that free accommodation in a motel close to the hospital, then the chances are you're limiting your opportunity to be connected with whānau. So part of that package is also about ensuring that we have free access to Wi-Fi and those sort of devices that can hopefully keep us connected.
You've also asked for more pay for nurses at this time. It's not a new call, right? It's a call you've been making for some time now. Why is that now specifically for now?
It is to address the exceptional circumstances under which we're working. It is to, this is over and above. So every nurse trains how to deal with and treat people in isolation. That's a given. But these are unprecedented times. We've seen internationally the amount of people that are dying across the world and the health professionals that have become infected due to inadequate access to PPE. So this is about recognising that. Particularly, it's about levelling up the platform. So we've been for a long time now, and far too long, talking about nurses that work within Māori and iwi providers don't get the same pay as their colleagues that work within District Health Board. Sometimes that gap's up to 25% difference. So this is about recognising that those frontline workers that are out there in the community deserve to be recognised equally with their peers that are working frontline in ICU units within District Health Boards.
Kerry Nuku, thank you very much for your time this morning. We do really appreciate it. Thank you also to the work that nurses are doing. Please extend our thanks and gratitude to them that are working at the front line. Tēnā rā tuku.
Kia ora.
Kerry Nuku there, the kaiwhakahaere of the Nurses National Organisation. Well, from health issues now to a Bay of Plenty regional councillor, actor and director Toi Iti. He's spending lockdown at home in Ruatoki within the Rohe Pōtai of Ngāi Tūhoi. He says COVID-19 has changed the way the regional council does business for now and possibly in the future, like for many of us. Lockdown's also made him think about how the future might look in a post-COVID-19 world and what opportunities there are to create change. He also has a word of warning for Māori struggling financially not to get caught up in multi-level marketing schemes doing the rounds on the internet, and a warning to stay away from all those conspiracy theories. Toi Iti is with me now from Ruatoki. Tēnā koe, Toi. Can we hear Toi? I think you need to unmute yourself.
Part of the tradition of doing Zooms and Skypes and everything is, hey, unmute yourself.
Thank you, Toi, for joining us. How are you spending your time in lockdown?
You know, at times like this, all the time actually, Shane, it is very good to be aware and to appreciate your privilege. I am here in Ruatoki, the whārua of Ruatoki. And we live in a beautiful part of the world. We have plenty of space, plenty of food, plenty of kai, and so we're doing the lockdown well. I'd be more than happy to have this as my new normal, Shane.
And you have great internet, by the looks of things, which is great.
Yeah, it's not bad.
Ka pai. Financially, a lot of Māori are hurting even more with COVID-19. What concerns do you have about some of the schemes people are getting into?
Yeah, you know, social media is a double-edged sword. At times like this, it keeps us together and we're able to connect to each other. But it also is a disseminator of really bad information. And at a time when whānau are incredibly vulnerable, financially, wondering what the future holds for them, things that they can come across on the internet can look attractive. Those too good to be true type stories suddenly become, well, maybe this could be my way out of this. And so multi-level marketing schemes have been around for a long time. Basically, they are pyramid schemes, but they attach themselves to a product. And so therefore they are legal. But there's quite a few of them out there, and the majority of whānau who do join up to these actually end up in debt. So my warning would be to do your due diligence. And I would actually like to see, much like around the work done with loan sharks, a lot more attention brought to this, because it brings genuine financial hardship to whānau who do join up to these organisations. So whether it's information campaigns that get released across social media that whānau can share as well, around doing your due diligence, around looking at the numbers, around the reality that people at this time are susceptible to hard sales techniques that are very effective.
As I'm listening to you, I can't help but be reminded of that well-known saying, if it seems too good to be true, it probably is, right?
Yeah, it is. And most of them are around direct sales, but they also, if you're going to make real money out of them, you have to get salespeople underneath you. This is what the main feature of a multi-level marketing scheme is that every time you sell a product, a share of your profits will be going to the layer above you. And so really to make money out of these schemes, you have to get a sales team below you. And they have all lots of different names, like diamond level and platinum level and all these kinds of things. That's usually a dead giveaway that it's a bit of a scam. But it genuinely hits a lot of people in the pocket.
Tell us about your role as a Bay of Plenty regional councillor. As with most of us, work must continue. What are some of the new ways that you're now having to work?
Yeah, well, just before the lockdown, we actually had have a emergency council meeting and elect a emergency committee so that we could pass, well, so that we could get on with the business of the day without being able to meet face-to-face because there's legislation around a quorum and us having to be in the same room. And they did not cover video conferencing. So as part of the emergency response bill that went through Parliament, they had to actually adjust legislation so that during the period of the lockdown, we are able to have a quorum via video conferencing, whether it's Zoom or Skype or whatever each local government council decides to roll. So those are the nitty gritty aspects of on the job getting things done.
Of course, we're all having to make change right now, but change that may stay around or further develop into the future. Lockdown has given us time to reflect on the future. What do you hope the future will look like when we come through all of this?
Yeah, it's this has been a time of reflection, Shane, and all of us, I'm sure, have been confronted with what is actually of value to us. You could look at Maslow's hierarchy of needs. You need shelter, you need food, water, but what we also need is whānau. And these are what we need. And in our race to, because we know this has had an economic impact on our economy, in our race to get back to our norm, we have to be really cognizant of what are we racing back to? Where are we resetting to? And there is the Crown infrastructure projects have asked local governments to put forward shovel-ready projects. And when you say the word shovel-ready, that does imply, you know, you're ready to go, but it's also you're talking about infrastructure. And the decisions that we make now will impact us for decades to come, because these are really big projects and you need to be really give some deep thought as to the projects that you are spending money on. But it is happening very quickly. And so this is the reality of the situation. Are we going to create a future that our future generations are going to be proud of and is it for the benefit of them? And how do we weigh that against our immediate needs of kickstarting our economy, getting people jobs and resetting to a place that is of benefit for us now.
Mm. A good way to probably leave our conversation. It's been a pleasure, Toi, talking to you this morning. Tēnā rā tū koe, and tukuna ngā mihi ki tō miru miru, ki tō whānau I kona. Tēnā koe.
Kia ora, tēnā koe.
Toi Iti there, proving that Ruatoki has very strong internet coverage. Ka pai. Well, moving on, the demand for food parcels is skyrocketing as whānau feel the pinch due to financial strain from COVID-19 restrictions. One of the largest food banks is Papakura Marae in South Auckland, and CEO Tony Kake joins me now. Tēnā koe, Tony.
Tēnā koe. Kia ora, Shane.
How high is demand for food parcels since COVID-19 compared with before?
I know there's 10 food bank services across Tāmaki Makaurau. One of the bigger ones that we're affiliated with is the Auckland City Mission. And I know we're doing about 1,000 food parcels a day. That's across the three distribution sites of Auckland City Mission in town, Ngā Whare Wātea, Mangere, and us here in Papakura. So collectively, we're doing about 1,000 a day. Yeah, no, it's huge. Eh? So, but some of us have got I've got a good arrangement with the Papakura Winds office as well, where they are picking up a lot of our regular food bank applicants or people that are usually coming to us every week anyway. So we've got a really good arrangement with Papakura Winds, and they're doing about 120 of our normal whānau per week, really. So otherwise, they're coming in thick and fast. We're fielding hundreds of calls every day, but of course we've only got enough supply to do out from our Papakura site about 55 per day.
Right. The demand seems absolutely extraordinary, 1,000 across three different sites going across Tāmaki Makaurau, but that's every day. Tell us what is in a food parcel so we get a better appreciation of, you know, are you providing food enough for a day, for a few days, for a week?
Yeah, so traditionally, before we went into COVID, it was supposed to only just kind of get you to your next payday or to your next income day. So, but these food parcels that we're giving out provision for a week, you know. We've had some awesome sponsors, Shane, some awesome contributors. So the packs aren't our usual couple of day supply, they're full on. And, you know, we've had good contributions from our local seed community that we're able to top up the City Mission parcels. Kiwi Harvest is another one. Even our local New World Papakura branch, Peter Lynch from down the New, they're all self owner-operated services, hey, and they've all come and wrapped their support around us. Chevalier is another major supplier. So I think tomorrow we're getting heaps of chips. You know, it's not the healthiest thing around, but at this time, you know, there's a heap of potato chips coming our way. So, but they're a good range of veggies from our seed community, good range of veggies and meats coming through. So they're substantial packs, which we're really, you know, really, really happy and proud to say that we can offer that out, give that out to our whānau.
So that's potentially 7,000 whānau that are being supported by this initiative, and that excludes other initiatives, right, that are being run and organised throughout Tāmaki Makaurau here. Do you have enough? Is it meeting the demand? Or are there whānau, in your experience, still missing out?
The fact that we're still harvesting, you know, hundreds of calls, our phone lines for food requests is just going through the roof. Now, it's your usual societal thing where you'll get about 3% of the community that are probably just topping up, you know, they've got, but the other 97% are probably really genuine. So when we do our assessments, we kind of can filter that out. And I think the demand is real. You know, people's circumstances have changed as of the last 3 weeks, and we've just got to, you know, take that into account. So, you know, the income, you know, part of the frustration is a lot of our whānau had jobs or had double incomes, you know, and they're gone. So we've got a lot of new clients, new whānau that are coming to our doorstep.
On Monday, the government will make a decision about what happens beyond this 4 weeks of lockdown. And I suspect, regardless of whatever they say, this demand for support in kai is not going to stop, right? So what's your message to government? What's your message to those watching now about what that may mean for you and the work, the services that you're providing?
So it's important that we tune into the messages of the government. They're probably going to announce some real clear guidelines around what a step down back to level three will look like. And I suspect it won't be the same as the level three we came into the situation. So there will be, I think it's about how we reset that, and Māori whānau need to be really aware of what those new terms and conditions are when they are announced. As a marae though, as Papakura marae, I don't think there'll be much of a change for us. We've been working in that kind of state since the COVID since we knew we were going to go into lockdown. So, you know, my staff, I've got 63 staff, they're all working, a lot of them are working from home, just the essential services like the clinic, the food bank, the distribution of hygiene packs, they're all coming in. So, you know, but we're still operating in terms of our social services over a phone call we're having to be really kind of innovative and creative in the way that we've had to engage with our whānau. And to be honest, Shane, it's been really neat, you know. Yeah. People understand that we're in a different situation and responding.
Rising to the challenge, right? Rising to that need. Yeah. Tony Koke, thank you so much for joining us this morning. And I'm glad you raised your kaimahi, your workforce, because please extend our thanks to them for the work that they're doing. To all of you out there at Papakura Marae, tēnā rā tuku.
Ngā mihi. Kia ora.
Tony Kake there, the CEO of Papakura Marae, and the great work that they're doing out there too. Well, next on the show, we talk about a new website being launched for whānau hauā called Pairangi. It was created by three Māori organisations that are committed to ensuring whānau Māori are better informed and prepared about COVID-19. Showing their commitment, we have Stephanie Āwhito, our sign language interpreter, who joins us for this particular segment, and Tipene Lemon, lead at Te Ohonga, and Tania Kingi, the lead of Te Rōpū Waiora, to talk to us about Pairangi. Tēnā rā tū koutou.
Tēnā koe, Shane. Mihi ki a koutou
katoa. Tania, maybe we start with you. Tell us about how Pairangi has come about.
I think we got together as the three organisations wanting to respond but not really sure how. There was so much work being done out in the community, and what we figured really early in the piece was that with all of the activity and the support and the amazing mahi that people were doing, no one had put together a menu, and certainly not a menu that our community could read in terms of who was doing what, when, to who, and how. And then we started looking at the COVID official information and realised that there was an awful lot of stuff. It wasn't all accessible. There was a lot of white noise, and I think our Māori communities were finding it hard, some of our communities were finding it hard to relate. So the idea of Pairangi was born, where we would find out who were doing who all the organisations were that were doing stuff out there. You've just had Tony Kake on, and he's been a huge advocate of this work. And we've been pulling that information down. We started with a list of 3,000 organisations here in Tāmaki Makaurau, and we've had to do a massive data cleanse just so whānau could access that list and in a way that was disability accessible and culturally relevant. So the unique thing about Pairangi is that I think it's the first ever where we've had a culturally relevant space that is also disability accessible. And on that basis, it means that everything that we provide on Pairangi is accessible to everyone. So we make this message really clear every time we talk to people. If it's accessible to our community, then it's accessible to everybody. It makes sense then that where you find help and what sort of information you need to be able to access can be provided to our community and therefore everybody else.
Congratulations on what you've been able to achieve. That's remarkable, actually. Tipene, how many marae and rōpū have come together to make this website a reality? And just how easy was it bringing everyone together?
E tino pātai anō tēnā, Shane. Pēne pēte ki i taku nei moeho ko te kotahi o Tāmaki, hei ngā takiwā o te 26 te rahinga o ngā marae ko Piritahi mai, i raro mai te maru o te kotahi o Tāmaki. Ko te pai o tēnei i te moeho o te iwi, he ara tēnei i te kaupapa mea ata waihotia ki te taha, me reira me Piritahi mai. Me reira tikana ki te mihi atu ki ngā ringa raupa, ngā ringa rehe, e piri mai ana ki te mahitahi i runga no tēnei kaupapa o taka mai ki ngā kia tātaka parua.
He ngāwari, he uaua rānei, te whakatōpū mai i ngā rōpū, i ngā iwi o Tāmaki Makaurau ki te whakatina nei te kaupapa nei?
Nā tō rātou piripono ki tēnei kaupapa me te mōhio pina kore rawa tātou mahitahi, a ka piha tātou, ne reira ke kaha tātou ki te tiaki mai a tātou, hau maru i a tātou, me te tiaki wa tātou nei whānau i tō tātou whakapapa. I runga ke tēnā, e māramana te Māori ki te āhuatanga o te mahitahi, nā o te kaupapa, e piri nei a tātou, pēnei te kaupapa o te pai tuku tuku nei, e waharoa o te pairangi, o te pai ki te ana tātou kei tu atu, reira, e piri nei a tātou tēnei taima tunu. Reira, aha ko wa tai taima e ua, engari i runga no te ahotanga o te kaupapa ko taka mai, e taima haruki ruki nei a tātou tēnei wā, mā mā nohio.
Tēnā koe, tēnā rau atu koe tīpene. Tania, what is the key message that you want to share with whānau today?
I think that there isn't one particular message. There's so much information, and your guests this morning have outlined a whole lot of stuff. I think what was evident, though, is that there's still a population of people who are missing out on the memo. And really, Pairangi is about that. We're hoping that we've got a range of ways that whānau can get the information, be informed, therefore be prepared, and then be compliant. And if we have pockets of whānau who aren't compliant or they're not informed or even prepared, then we're all at risk. So really, it's making sure that we have the space that whānau can come to. We have kōrero that's in easy read English. It's in audio English. It's in audio te reo. We have sign language throughout all of our messages. And we have a special place that we've just created, and it's kōrero with some experts. So the Māori doctors, Rōpū, Tony has been on. We've had Rereata Makiha. We're planning Rangi Mātāmua. We want that kind of conversation and the impact that this pandemic has had on te ao Māori to be a conversation that our community can access. And as I say, when they can access it, everybody can.
Tēnā rau atu koe, Tania Kingi, and of course Tipene Lemon, and our beautiful Stephanie Āwhito for joining us this morning. Of course, we will put the details of the website up on our Facebook page so that our whānau can access it. Hoi anō e mihi atu ana ki a koutou katoa.
Tēnā koe.
Ka pai. Well, yesterday, kura around the motu started day one of term two. Everyone has had to adapt classroom mahi to online learning to keep their tamariki engaged. The kaiako e tōku māpihi Māori a kura kaupapa Māori are using fun ways to finish their morning karakia. Mā taki mai.
Hai, korite. I know it's getting late now, baby. Maybe you should stay here with me. Let's just make it all for party.
We may have to look to introduce that to our karakia at Māori Television one day. However, with me now to talk about online learning is Kiriata Kuiti. Tēnā rau atu koe.
Tēnā koe.
How was the move to online classrooms? How was it easy? Was it difficult? Challenging?
It was challenging in two parts, I suppose. It was easy because we have been doing online mahi and kura for a while now. The challenging part was ensuring all of our tamariki had access to devices and we're able to access the mahi using the different taupanga that we've been using in kura. Another issue is a lot of our tamariki, there's three or four of them living in the one whare. Mm. And so making sure that our kaimahi don't upload all their mahi or organise to have their hui kūkara or their zui at the same time and somebody has to miss out on their household. So it's just for making sure that us as kaiako are taking that on board and thinking about our tamariki in all of the whare, not just our class.
So a bit of trial and error, it sounds like. Of course, day two is today, and I'm sure it's going to be a better day than day one. Tell me about the system Seesaw that your kura use.
Seesaw's an amazing taupanga that allows us to upload lessons, whether it be links to YouTube or links to websites. We can upload Google Slides, Google Docs for the kids to work on, and when they've completed the mahi, they then upload that to Seesaw and we can see it. As a kaiako, we can go on, we can mark it, we can leave messages, their classmates can leave messages, and also the whānau can jump on board and make comments on their own tamariki's mahi.
Do you feel supported as you embark on this new way of teaching? Have you got the resources that you need to be able to carry this out?
Yes and no. in terms of the IT, there's always opportunities there in different taupanga. Fortunately, in New Zealand, there's a lot of online forums with kaiako around the country, both Māori medium and mainstream, sharing resources. And so we're not reinventing the wheel. We can jump on and post up and ask someone, have you done something like this? What can we do to do this? How can you help? What can we do better? I suppose the difficulty lies in our children who struggle to follow those instructions, and those children that have individual education plans, and making sure we can work one-to-one with them or find time to work with them independently rather than in a group of 50 or 60 students.
How long are you preparing for in terms of operating like this, providing distance learning via the ipurangi, via online? How long are you preparing for?
At this stage, we're going week by week. So our kaimahi e toku mapahi have planned for the next 8 days and have uploaded mahi to Seesaw that will cover the tamariki for 8 days. We're not expecting our tamariki to be online from 9 till 3. We haven't uploaded mahi that will take up 7 hours, 5 hours of school time. We've uploaded tasks that they can complete in their own time, that they can complete as a whānau. And not necessarily a lot of new learning, but re-engaging and reaffirming what they've learnt before we went on lockdown. So at this stage, 8 days, and then we'll have a staff hui and meet with our tūmaki and then lay another plan to see what's going to happen next. But at this stage, we're just going week by week.
Because, of course, your focus now is right providing instruction via online. Then, of course, there's that whole new world that you have to enter in terms of returning back to the classroom and whatever that may look like.
Yeah, and that's all up in the air at the moment. We're not too sure as kaimahi what that's going to look like. Or even before the lockdown, we had parents keeping their tamariki at home. So we've had a lot of kids who this will end up being maybe 2 months of them being in lockdown before they even come back to kura. And so that's why we use Google and we use Zoom, so we can do the face-to-face with them and we can catch up with them online. But yeah, I'm not too sure what it's going to look like.
I think you're not the only one. Kiriata, kuiti, tēnā rau atu koe me tō whakawāte I a koe anō kia tapatahi te atanei mihi atu ana ki a koe o tira ki ngā kaiako katoa huri noi te motu.
Kia ora.
Nurses, doctors, teachers, he mihi nui ki a koutou katoa. Now, don't forget, whānau, we've launched a competition where you could win $1,000. $1,000. All you need to do is create a 5-minute video that shows the motu what you're doing during lockdown, and it must be fun. We'll announce the winner at the end of lockdown, which could be as soon as next week. Nā reira, kia kaha kia tere. Tā koutou tuku mai a koutou kiriata. You can go to our Māori Television Facebook page, like it, don't forget to like it, and DM your video through. It's that easy. Well, we leave you today with a waiata from our friends at Lockdown Entertainment, Lani Ketu and Nina Pilkington. Koe nā tapatahi mo tēnei rā, kia piki te ora te kaha me te māramatanga kia koutou katoa. Hei ko nā mo tēnei wā. Yeah.
Hello.